Welcome to Yong Tuition. I am Yong. Do you remember I said I will discuss energy, heat, and work in depth in my recent talks? Today, I'm going to talk about the related basic issues. Or should I say, I will going to discuss the related issues because it seems unlikely one talk is enough. So, are you ready? I mean to like, to subscribe, and to share, as well as to activate your little bell so that you would not miss any of my new talks. Let's go and have fun. The world we have known is constantly in motion, from tiny biochemical molecules to clouds in the atmosphere, and to the heavenly bodies such as the sun and the moon. Indeed, every object is in motion according to Galileo's relativity. But why? This is an old question which can be traced back at least to Aristotle in ancient Greek, one of the students of Plato whose teacher was Socrates. According to Aristotle, the reason why an object is moving is because some force is always acting on it. Further, he argued that the velocity is proportional to the force. Hence, motion is due to force. Sounds convincing, right? This could be the logic of introducing so-called living force I'm going to discuss today. For nearly 2,000 years after Aristotle, nobody had questioned this idea until Galileo grew up. Unlike others, Galileo investigated natural phenomena based on experiments. This is his inclined motion experimental setup. When an object is moving along the inclined surface, one can argue that the motion is driven by the gravity. Sounds consistent with Aristotle's claim. Once the object moves to the horizontal track, the motion is slowed down until it completely stopped after moving of a distance, say d, called displacement. One could say, simple, it is caused by friction. However, the young Galileo didn't stop his thinking there. Instead, he asked himself, what would happen if the friction, including the air resistance, were gradually diminished? The conclusion drawn from his thought experiment was unexpected. An object would spontaneously keep its velocity forever. So, Aristotle was wrong. A new concept was born called inertia. The most strange behavior of the non-living object. One may call it as stubbornness. It was a paradigm shift in humans' history in understanding the nature. Motion just exists without any external force. The moving atoms, the moving planets and satellites, even the growth of trees and our thoughts are independent of Aristotle's force. That's why one can think freely once all constraints are disposed. I will return to Galileo's inclined motion experiment because more new insights into motion can be gained from this simple experiment. Galileo's inertia was incorporated into Newton's three laws of mechanics, the first one. Further, the relation between a change in velocity of an object and the force exerted was formulated by Newton, m equal to ma, where a equal to the first derivative of velocity with respect to time is acceleration. Known as the second law at the core of Newtonian mechanics. I remember my teacher said Newton was merely puzzled by the first push, because he believed that his mechanics, based on his calculus, can predict any mechanical motion given the first push. That's why he spent years to study alchemy and thermology apart from physics. However, another basic issue emerged during the 17th century from studying collisions between objects, such as this one demonstrated with this Newton's cradle. As you can see, something must have been transferred among the metal balls. But what is this something? Initially, the something was simply called as motion. But soon, two seemingly exclusive opinions were formed. One was mv, eventually known as a momentum, where m is mass and v is velocity. Notice that both Descartes and Newton were in favor of using momentum, but Newton's momentum is a vector, whereas Descartes' momentum is a scalar. Another is mv square, advocated by Leibniz, Newton's rival, perhaps as you might have known. As early as 1638, Galileo wrote in his dialogues concerning two new sciences, "In the absence of resisting the media, vertical fall is a uniformly accelerated motion, and hence the square of speed acquired during the fall is proportional to the height of the fall." So one could argue that Leibniz was not alone. In 1686, Leibniz published a short note entitled "A Brief Demonstration of the Notable Error of Descartes and Others Concerning of a Natural Law." Obviously, the others here included Newton. In this note, Leibniz first openly rejected the quantity of motion used by Descartes, namely the product of the mass and velocity. In essence, Leibniz believed the world and the whole universe as a huge and sophisticated machine with a magical God-given substance. The quantity of motion he preferred, he named the substance as vis viva in Latin, meaning living force. Can you see, Leibniz reconsidered the basic issue why objects move as if the concept inertia were unknown. His logic was an object moves because it possesses certain amount of living force, a kind of reinvention of will. What do you think? As a mathematician, Leibniz wouldn't discuss his philosophical idea without using a formula. He wrote his vis viva as m squared, where m is mass and v is velocity. But of course, mv squared is a scalar. If you studied physics before, then you could recognize the vis viva is twice as much kinetic energy, Ek equal to half mv squared. Therefore, you could guess his living force could be kind of energy rather than a force defined in Newtonian mechanics. Indeed, some historians nowadays argue that Leibniz was the first to have the concept energy, and even the father of energy transformation and conservation law. But if you study in depth, it is evident such an argument might have oversimplified the actual process for physicists to understand energy. Notice that it seems impossible for Leibniz to quantify his living force without considering the effect of motion. That's to say, how much damage or deformation or sound or heat might be caused by stopping a moving object at speed v. This implies that this Viva could just be a matrix or a number rather than a substance that can be transported. So think about it, please. In passing, Newton didn't include Leibniz's living force in his Principia, although he knew Leibniz's argument. Was it because he disliked Leibniz due to their dispute on who invented calculus first? Partially, but not the main reasons, I think. In my opinion, Newton wouldn't only use a scalar such as kinetic energy to describe the effect that can be caused by a mechanical motion, simply because the direction of motion should also be taken into account. In 1807, 6 years after he performed his famous double slit experiment, the charming 34 years old Yong called Leibniz's vis viva as energy for the first time. By talking to his audience, most of them were married women. The living force is something more concisely expressed by the term energy. But as I discussed, one could only argue the living force has unit of energy at that stage. In 1829, a breakthrough in describing Leibniz's living force was made by Coriolis, who is known for the Coriolis force nowadays, as widely mentioned in studying weather and CRI mate. However, his first work on work is much more fundamental in physics, I think. Coriolis, at age of 37, gave the first definition for work in physics, which appeared in his new book on the physics of machine, namely, work is the force times the distance in the direction of motion. Further, he shown, by invoking Newton's second law and calculus, that work is equal to the change of kinetic energy, Ek equal to half mv squared, which is a half of the Leibniz living force. So Newton had very reason not to discuss Leibniz's living force in his Principia, as he wouldn't be surprised the work energy theorem could be derived from his second law. As you can see, it took nearly 1.5 centuries for physicists to understand what Leibniz's living force is. In other words, Leibniz was wrong to express his vis viva as m squared, although its unit is a joule. If you haven't studied Newton's calculus, let's return to Galileo's inclined motion experiment. Assuming the friction force is a constant and the horizontal distance before the object stops is d, we have work W equal to F times D. On the other hand, assuming the velocity when the object arrives the ground is V and the final velocity is zero, we can use the formula V squared equal to 2 times acceleration times displacement. Multiply mass M and divide it by 2, we obtained half mv squared equal to fd, where we have used Newton's second law, f equal to ma, done by using high school physics. To summarize briefly, one, the living force is not a force in Newtonian mechanics, but a scalar quantity with unit of energy. Two, the living force is associated with the accumulated effect of force in space, first revealed by Coriolis as a work. Three, the living force mv squared is twice as much of kinetic energy, derived from Newton's second law of mechanics. Therefore, Leibniz was wrong if his living force is considered as energy. Four, kinetic energy and momentum are two complementary quantities of mechanical motion. Both of them can be used as matrices to calculate how much motion is transferred during conditions. Of course, this is just the first talk about energy, so please stay tuned and tell your friends or classmates to watch this channel for everyone who is interested in physics. Thank you for watching. Thank you for donation. See you next time.